Hello, in today's Bug Bounty Report Explain, you will learn dependency confusion. It's a new hacking technique that was revealed in 2021 and earned the researcher much more than $130,000. The good news is that there are still hundreds of thousands to be earned. Watch the video till the end to get to know how to do it. The article was originally published on Medium by Alex Bearson. Links, as always, are in the description. Enjoy! When creating applications in any programming language, we use many third-party libraries. They are pieces of code written by other users. And to use someone's library, we must trust them enough to run their code on our machine or on our server. And there are tools that make using other libraries easier, like npm for JavaScript, pip for Python, or gem for Ruby. In my examples, I will mostly stick to Python's pip because it's probably what most of us is familiar with. When you want to install a library, you run this command. It may seem like this package is official or at least verified by someone, but it's not the case. Everyone can create their package if the name is not taken. You don't need anything besides a free account on PyPI website and organizing your project in specified structure. Attacking libraries is not a new idea. For years, attackers have been creating malicious libraries with mistyped names of popular packages, creating malicious pull requests, or somehow gaining a maintainer status and committing a bad code to known library. However, this researcher found a new attack vector which proved to be a goldmine. When you are a big company, many of your systems do similar functionalities and integrate with the same solutions. It means a lot of code is rewritten or copied from project to project. So to make things more efficient and secure, you create private libraries that can be then reused across the whole company. You can't, however, publish this code to PyPI because it's confidential. So you create a private repository. Then you can just add extra index URL parameter to pip install and pip will look there for the package you want to use. There is also index URL parameter. The difference is that the former will look for the package both in the public and in the private repository, while the latter will only look in the private one. So when you have mixed public and private dependencies, you want to use extra index URL. The question is, what would happen if both the public and the private repository would have the dependency that you want to install? My logic would suggest that the package from the private repository would have higher priority, but it's not the case. Turns out that pip chooses the library with the higher version. And what's important, when publishing a new package, user can specify any version that he wants. So if a company uses private Python library called company authentication, anyone can go to PyPI, create a public package with that name, and when someone in this company runs this command to install the private dependency, the one created by a malicious user from the public repository will be downloaded because it had higher version. You then gain RCEs on servers, on CI/CD pipelines, and even on developer PCs. So the impact of this is even higher than the impact of RCE in web app. Because good web apps are created with the idea in mind that there might be an RCE, so the network is separate from the corporate one, there are least privileges, and the traffic is also limited. But executing code on developer PC is a lovely spot to run ransomware. That's the theory. Now it was time for the researcher to start practical attacks in as automated way as possible. When his malicious libraries were run, he only collected system's username, hostname and current path so that he didn't possess any very confidential information, but was still able to prove the vulnerability. And when creating a library, you can create a script that will be executed upon installation before even executing the library. That's what he used to send data back to him from those scripts. However, a lot of servers use firewalls that block outgoing HTTP traffic, so the researcher exfiltrated data using DNS protocol. It's normally used to resolve domain names and it's rarely blocked by firewall. So his scripts were trying to resolve domain names with those exfiltrated information that were also hex encoded. The queries were eventually reaching his DNS server, where he collected all the data and inserted it into a database. But now came the biggest challenge: how to get those private package names. First, the researcher targeted some companies and tried to find their leaked names on GitHub, on package hosting services, or even on different forums. But this approach was very time-consuming, not really efficient, and not at all automatable. The best source turned out to be JavaScript files. Because when you are creating a Node.js application, some of the JavaScript code gets bundled into the client-side JavaScript code, which is of course available to the user. And npm uses package.json file to store those dependency names, and apparently this file quite often gets bundled into this client-side code. And finding package names using this approach was much better because it's fully automatable. With help of his friend, Alex scanned thousands of domains of targeted companies that leaked hundreds of private package names. Then, when having names of those private packages, they created public ones with respective names and waited to hear from the callback scripts. Multiple RCEs on developer PCs, on-premise and cloud servers, and development pipelines. At the moment of writing the article, 35 companies were affected. Good thing about such attack is that it's usually big companies that use private packages. So most of the targets were big corporations. And good thing about big corporations is that they have bug bounty programs with big payouts. And rewards for those reports were usually maximum and sometimes even higher than maximum. For example, Shopify was pwned with Shopify Cloud Library and paid $30,000. Another $30,000 came from Apple and yet another one from PayPal. The biggest reward, however, came from Azure, which paid $40,000. So in total, we have $130,000 and it's only 4 out of 35 companies. The author also mentioned that he pwned Netflix, Yelp and Uber. If they would also pay their respective maximums, we would have another $85,000 here. It would be a total of $215,000 for 7 out of 35 companies. Huge congratulations to the author from me. I think we have a strong contender for 2021 hacking technique here. The researcher only focused on npm, pip and gem, but 75% of all callbacks came from JavaScript libraries. Was the difference such big because of higher error rate in this technology? Likely no, The reason is that for JavaScript, it was the easiest to find package names. For example, for Ruby gems, the researcher only found packages of 8 organizations, out of which 4 were pwned. It means, if you only knew those names, you could make good money yourself. And there are still many unexplored areas in other programming languages. And keep in mind that the researcher pwned 35 companies, which is a huge achievement, but it's not a big number compared to the amount of bug bounty programs out there. That's why I think there is still a lot of money to be earned with dependency confusion. And that's it. It's by far the highest reward for a bug covered on my channel. I hope that some of you will also be able to report a few dependency confusion vulnerabilities. Let me know in the comment section if you will. Anyway, if you feel like you've learned something new today, leave a like and leave a subscription. Thanks for watching and goodbye.